Well, I want to emphasize Andrea's closing remarks there. This was a really informative session, and I think I can speak for us all, saying that we have a bunch of tools and thoughts to bring with us as we start redefining our own priorities. And I'm really excited also to introduce our moderators for our next panel. Dr. Ellen Mitchell and Dr. Elise Mosser will be moderating our next session on individual and structural strategies to overcome inequities. And again, if you have questions, please direct them in the chat and we can try to get those answered.
So thanks so much. Looking forward to another great session. So today's panel discussion, the second session, is on individual and structural strategies to overcome inequalities. Our focus is going to be on the obstacles faced by women and historically excluded individuals in their careers in academic medicine and research. The purpose is to shed light on the inequalities and discuss solutions to overcome them. We've assembled a distinguished group of experts in the field who will provide us with valuable insights and practical strategies. Through this interactive session, we'll have the opportunity to engage in a dynamic exchange of ideas and solutions. Our panelists will address the questions of how we can leverage national programs and our own positions to negotiate for more equitable outcomes. The discussion will also highlight resources available to overcome the inequities faced by women and historically excluded individuals in academic medicine and research. So without further ado, let's begin this discussion on individual and structural strategies to overcome inequalities. We're confident by the end of this session, we will have a deeper understanding of the challenges faced by women and historically excluded individuals and be inspired to take action to create a more equitable future. So I'm going to have each of our panelists introduce themselves and then describe how you feel negotiation has shaped your career trajectory. I ask Dr. Bernard to go first.
So I'm Marie Bernard, the NIH Chief Officer for Scientific Workforce Diversity. And as I like to say, I've earned all my gray hair. I've gone from being an academician, chair of a Department of Geriatric Medicine, to being a Fed. And at every step of the way, there was negotiation that was necessary. I will say I've not done a great job of that, as is reflected by people of my generation. I kind of took what was given to me, and I stand in awe of my millennial daughter who's moved up the food chain at her company, being very thoughtful and cognizant at every step of her negotiation. And I wish for all of you all of her traits.
That's a great one. Dr. Clayton, can you introduce yourself next?
Sure. I'm Janine Austin Clayton. I'm the NIH Associate Director for Research on Women's Health. And in that capacity, I get to direct the Office of Research on Women's Health and work with all the 27 institutes and centers at NIH that all have women's health research portfolios. I have to say that I feel like I've had to negotiate in one way or the other for everything that I've accomplished. And I might not have called it negotiation, but you have to advocate for yourself for everything that you get. That is not just about salary. And certainly I've had some challenging experiences in that regard. So I want to leave you with just a quote, and I can't remember who said it, but it was, if nobody's telling you no, then you probably aren't asking for enough. Mm-hmm. And then the second thing is, you know, you might not get everything you ask for. So for me, how it's shaped my career is I need to be strategic and thoughtful about which things to ask for when, because they have to matter to me the most, and keeping the long term in mind. So not this negotiation is so important that I'm going to be tooth and nail on it, if that in the end is not going to serve my overall end goal.
That's great. I'm Dr. McNeal-Trice.
Hi, I'm Kenya McNeal-Trice. I'm a professor of pediatrics at the University of North Carolina School of Medicine. My career administratively has been within medical administration. I've served as not only our director of student education and pediatric program director, but I'm the vice chair of education here with our within our Department of Pediatrics. I've served as an interim dean for our diversity, equity, inclusion here at our university, and most recently as the designated institution official for our ACGME programs. And that That is the role of Chief Graduate Medical Education Officer for our hospitals and Senior Associate Dean for Graduate Medical Education. And then nationally and statewide, I'm president of our of the North Carolina Pediatric Society, which has been a wonderful joy. And I've had wonderful times serving on the steering committee for the AAMC group on women in medicine and science. And I would say for me, with regards to negotiation, I didn't know what negotiation was when I first negotiated my first faculty appointment. Sponsorship and mentorship were beyond vital for me. And I know we'll go on to answer some more questions about that. But I think one of the key things for me in having a broad mentorship circle that includes individuals very different than me is that it opened up the door of what I could actually ask for or negotiate for. I remember not even, I remember being provided some advice and my first thing out of my mouth was, I didn't even know that was a thing. I didn't know you could ask, what, you can ask for that and they'll actually give it to you? So that was beyond, that was beyond helpful with me, and we'll go for it. I know we'll go further into stories, but I would not be at my position right now in academic medicine had I not had guidance on negotiating my initial faculty offer 15 years ago.
Mm-hmm. Great. And Dr. Irons.
Hi, I'm Mira Irons. It's good to see everybody. I'm the current president and CEO of the College of Physicians of Philadelphia. I have an adjunct professor appointment at Penn in medicine and pediatrics and genetics. But my path was that I spent 30 years in academic medicine in Boston, most recently as chief of clinical genetics at Boston Children's and the director of the Harvard training programs in genetics, but then did a pivot to national medical organizations and was the senior vice president of academic affairs at the American Board of Medical Specialties at the height of the maintenance of certification wars, or whatever we want to call it, where I learned how to deal with work in hostile environments, but also we were able to shift, really turn a really large ship around to provide a more reasonable form of physician assessment. And then went to the American Medical Association of all places as chief health and science officer before I took this position in Philadelphia now. So have had experience negotiating in very different organizations. I think that the one thing I have learned, and I think it's what I've heard from the other speakers here, is if you don't ask, you're not going to get anything. And, you know, there is that book, Women Don't Ask. And the reality is that you do have to ask, but you also have to understand, you have to have done your homework. You have to know who the decision makers are, sort of what their boundaries are. You know, you learn that in any negotiation classes, you have to understand what the boundaries are. And so you have to know, and you have to know who you're negotiating with. I have always said that I negotiate for others much better than I negotiate for myself. And I too have a daughter who's a surgical resident now, who's very clear about what she wants. And I think in my generation, we kind of just took things, you know, and then tried to work with them. But I do think that understanding what's possible, what is impossible, and that actually there's an intermediate path to where you want to go is always, always important.
That's great. So one obstacle faced by women and historically excluded individuals in their careers in academic medicine and research may include salary inequality. So let's start with the Zoom poll for our audience to get a sense of any salary inequalities that they have experienced. So it seems like most people definitely had concern about their salary. That was the leading answer, either no or not sure, definitely covered a large portion. And then as far as a startup package, also definitely some concerns. And then a lot of people, a third, not even getting a startup package. So very few people feel confident that theirs was equitable. So thanks for participating.
And I'll Just going to some specific questions for each of the panelists now. I'm Elise Mosser. I'm an assistant professor in the Department of Microbiology and Immunology. So, you know, with these results in mind, let's explore several important questions with our panelists related to disparities in funding, entry and advancement in medicine, and national initiatives, as well as what we can do ourselves to address these inequities. So we're going to go ahead and start with Drs. Clayton and Bernard. Can you please share with us the NIH's perspective on disparities in funding? I think you have some slides to share.
We have a few slides to share. We could spend the whole hour talking about this topic, but just at a very, very, like 100,000 foot level, we wanted to kind of set the stage from our perspective. We at NIH think it's really, really important to have women and individuals from groups that have traditionally been underrepresented in science involved with all of our activities, because the sorts of challenges that we're trying to address in biomedical and behavioral research are like trying to describe an elephant without sight. You have to approach it from a lot of different directions. And we know a lot about what we need to do, and we know that we're not doing it as well as we could. When you look at, for instance, racial and ethnic representation among people who get R01 grants, as you know, you get an R01, if there's tenure at your institution, you're likely to get tenure, versus representation in the general STEM population versus the general US population. We do really well with non-Hispanic whites and Asians, but we have room for improvement in terms of Hispanics and Latinos and Blacks and African Americans. And when you look at the issue of women, these data are already a little bit old, but it hasn't changed dramatically. At the beginning of the professoriate, at the instructor level, there's great representation of women. This is underrepresented women in green, well-represented women in orange, underrepresented men in purple, well-represented men in blue. The women actually, percentage-wise, are greater than the men. But as you move upward through the professoriate to the level of department chair, that diversity is not there, and we're missing out on opportunities as a result of that. Thus, it's really necessary for us to do things at the individual level to support people, to do mentoring, to do sponsoring, et cetera. But it's also necessary for us to do things at the institutional level to make sure that the environment is supportive and make sure that we retain all of the wonderful talent that we have. I'm going to turn it over to Dr. Clayton to elaborate.
Thank you, Dr. Bernard. So if you take a look at this graph, it shows over a four-year period RPG research project grant rates for women investigators and men investigators. And you can see these success rates have increased slightly over time. That orange bar is women only, and the blue is men only. If you click again, Marie, and then click one more time for me. But if you drill down into different populations of women over the same four-year period, I want to draw your attention and click one more time for Marie, from 2016 to 2020. On the far left in the light blue is Black or African American women. And as you see in 2016, they're 11.3% success rate for RPGs. And 2020, we've gotten an increase that looks like 16.9%, and that's what is circled by the oval. If you look at the other groups, the second bar, kind of a teal bar, is Asian women, and that has increased slightly. The next bar, the orange bar, is Hispanic, and there is somewhat of an increase. And you can see the green bar is other non-white individuals, and the blue bar is white women. So we do see some change over time, but there still is a disparity here. Next slide, please, Marie. And this is our multifaceted approach, and I know we'll get a chance to talk about these during the panel, but just wanted to highlight the fact that I had the privilege of working with Dr. Bernard, Dr. Wolinitz, and Ten Hagen also on trying to summarize our strategy, realizing that we definitely need to do things differently going forward to have more impact, and that a multifaceted coordinated approach is needed. The five elements that we talked about as critical were demonstrable leadership support, action-oriented accountability, research on interventions and generating best practices, enhanced flexibility options, and the importance of a culture of inclusion as one way to advance inclusive excellence. Back to you, Dr. Bernard.
Okay. And we have a initiative that was launched unveiled February 26th of 2021 at a special meeting of the advisory committee to the director that's very specifically focusing in on enhancing the diversity of individuals who come from backgrounds, racial and ethnic backgrounds that are not well represented in the sciences. We called this NIH Unite Initiative. Each letter represents five independent working groups. The primary content areas that this initiative focuses on is minority health and health disparities research, looking internally to make sure that we have our own house in order so that we can role model what we expect of the external workforce. Some of the things that are externally facing that hopefully you're aware of is that we have something called the Science Education Partnership Awards. It has been a program managed by the National Institute of General Medical Sciences for many, many years, a K through 12 STEM education program. And last year we expanded it to 17 of our institute centers and offices because we recognize that when you look at the K through 12 population, there's quite a bit of diversity there. And that science identity gets solidified as early as middle school. So we thought it was important to make this outreach. We also have several concepts that got approved by the National Institute of General Medical Sciences Council. That means that it's very likely you'll see these as funding opportunity announcements in the near future. Takes a while, it was last May. Some of them I know will be imminent. Some like an institutional climate assessment and DEIA action plan to address that issue of making sure that the environment is truly receptive and supportive of women and individuals from racial and ethnic groups that are underrepresented. An opportunity to apply for funds to recognize excellence in DEIA as an investigator. An opportunity for minority serving institutions to get grant funds for instrumentation. Approved by the National Institute of Minority and Health Disparities, opportunity to do internal assessment of minority serving institutions to determine what their needs are and to develop an action plan to be more successful in getting NIH and NSF of other sorts of funds. And very importantly, I want to advertise that my team, the COSWID team, has put out for the second year now the opportunity for administrative supplements to recognize excellence in DEIA mentoring. We're going to be talking a lot about mentoring. It's not compensated in most cases. And for women and for individuals who come from minoritized populations, we don't come into this with built-in networks to help us to move forward. So being able to recognize those mentors who've done a great job and to help support them continuing to do more, we're offering this opportunity for up to $250,000 in 1 year if you're at a high-resource institution. Up to $250,000 for 2 years if you're in a low resource institution, and applications are due imminently. So hopefully you've already applied and you've already thought about this and you already know about it. But we just thought we would share some of those top level things to foster some of the conversation.
Great, thank you. That's really wonderful to know. You know, one thing that was mentioned was that the interest in science really starts very early. So, you know, Dr. Irons, this question is for you. In the medical field, what disparities do you find that prevent entry and advancement into medicine?
All great questions. I think that, you know, if we talk about entry into medicine, I mean, clearly it is, it's stimulating that interest, not, you know, in your senior year of college, but in high school and early on. You know, you have to start early. And in many schools, girls, young women, girls are dissuaded from careers in medicine and science and sort of shifted or forced, you know, into other liberal arts areas. But, you know, one of the things we have at the College of Physicians is we actually have four or five targeted programs to teenagers and underrepresented groups in the communities to encourage careers in STEM and healthcare. You know, we have one focused on Black males. We have one focused on underrepresented groups. We have an LGBT group, and we also have one focused on girls from the African diaspora. And about a 98% rate of those kids actually going into college from, you know, the communities in Philadelphia. So, you know, we'll see how that works out. The programs have been going on, some of them for 10 years. And I think that you have to start talking to young people early. They also have to have, and this was actually, I learned this from one of the teachers in that program, who was a young woman that grew up in the Philadelphia area and was in the first cohort of that program, especially with regards to the Black males, is that they don't really feel that they have a path. They don't know anyone who has actually had a path into medicine or healthcare institutions. So teaming them up with medical students that come from the same backgrounds they have has been incredibly important. But, you know, just to shift to people who are already, you know, in academic medicine as physicians, you know, I too have focused more recently on structural changes, then I think we have to support individuals. But if you're ever going to have long lasting change, you really have to focus on structural changes. And to be honest, in many ways, thinking about the barriers to achieving gender equity is no different than what hospitals and academic institutions have done to address other important systemic issues, you know, patient safety, quality improvement, diagnostic error. You know, longstanding systemic processes and procedures need to be examined. You have to ask why. You have to notice who's not in the room when you look around every day, and you have to negotiate change to make lasting difference. It's really too important to patients and faculty. To patients and families to rely on individuals to fix this themselves. You know, there's several areas when I think about it, and I don't want to spend a lot of time. One is that there are many competing priorities, you know, that institutions and others have, and it is up to us. We have to think about it. We have to talk about it. We have to think about it again and again and again and be intentional. You can't assume that others are going to take this up for us. Historical, you know, while more women are becoming physicians, senior leaders are still largely male. And they have this kind of view of what academic medicine looks like and how things happen. Medicine's also a profession with a clear hierarchy of rules and processes regarding how you rise through the ranks into leadership positions, what's needed to get noticed or considered for promotion. It's changing, but long-held procedures and perceptions are not very porous. And quite often, because it requires time, energy, and a clear path to change them. So I would suggest that people just assume they're semi-permeable membranes and try to move things along. Societal issues, you know, women still largely have responsibility for childcare, household responsibilities. And then again, in their senior years, you know, and their more senior faculty positions with elder care. And this all became painfully clear during the pandemic. And sadly, you know, I talked about the daughter earlier that is clear about what she wants. She still complains about the same things I complained about 35 years ago. In my residency. And, you know, every time I hear it, having spent a lot of time in my career in GME, all I can think about was, I thought we changed this. So, you know, you have to keep a focus on these things. I heard someone earlier talk about perceptions of what an academic career path is and what younger faculty have to do to prove themselves. This is really tricky because some of these attitudes are also held by senior women in leadership positions, because that's what we had to do to advance in order to be noticed. And, you know, we have to rethink what the expertise is for women to take on senior leadership roles. It might not be what we thought 20 or 30 years ago to become a dean or a senior leader. And then there are obviously, you know, structural issues with regards to institutional flexibility. You know, having childcare, having flexible time for young faculty, young surgical faculty, having block OR time that isn't at 7 p.m. on a Tuesday night, so that you'll never see your kids. But I think the first, and I'll, you know, end with this. I think the first thing to say is, like, notice who's in the room, ask why. Why are the processes and procedures what they are? And then think about what we can do to help fix them. Because if you fix them at the institutional level, we may have a chance here.
Great, thank you. And kind of shifting more than at the training level, Dr. McNeal-Trice, please, what disparities do we need to overcome to ensure equitable entry in the medical programs and success for our trainees once they're there?
Well, thank you. I often think about this question when considering both undergraduate medical education, graduate medical education, and then continual work in academic medicine. And one of the things I've often talked with my trainees about how hard it is to make it through and survive versus even thrive within medical school, whether you're getting a medical degree or you're getting a PhD in graduate education or in a basic science or even within our fellowship and residency programs. That we are trying to progress and navigate a system that wasn't made for us. And how do I, you know, what I describe with that is the system, even the timing of how things are relegated for an academic year, how courses are scheduled, the fact that there is, you know, very little wiggle room for any type of life instance. And my favorite saying is life doesn't care that you're a medical student. Life really doesn't care that you're a resident or a fellow. You're going to experience illness. Your family members are going to get sick. Your relationships are going to go through turmoil. We have experiencing more and more. You may want to start a family and may not be able to with regard to having children. Or don't even get me started with infertility and the increasing challenges that I see more and more young families having with trying to do that. And our system wasn't made for that. Our system wasn't made for those life experiences or for individuals to have to navigate that. It wasn't made for individuals who actually needed the income to live. It wasn't made for individuals who were going to have a baby or think about it during that time. And when I talk about their partners, it wasn't made for individuals who actually may want to be at their child's birth and at home for, you know, a couple weeks afterwards. And so if it's hard, it should be. We're in 2023 and our systems for this haven't changed much in the past 70 years, despite everything that we've done to evolve our timing of training. The very little time you may have off to do that in Western medicine hasn't changed. And that imparts significant disparities to those who are coming in with exceptional amount of educational loan debt, who may be coming in and they're the first in their family to enter college, let alone medical or graduate school. And they don't know what I often call the hidden curriculum. That other individuals have grown up around, that creates disparities. If you have a different ability or disability, our systems are not made to navigate that. And whether that may be physical, whether it may be mental or educational, if your system doesn't recognize and provide support for that, you're on your own. And that creates significant disparities. And so one of the favorite exercises I often do when I am giving some either a workshop or a talk about this is I ask individuals who are in academic medicine to think of a medical student or a trainee who they feel as though the system failed, that this person struggled, they worked as hard as they could. They did everything within their power, but they truly felt like this person truly felt like the system failed them. And I said, just think of one. And everybody's able to think of at least one person that they've encountered. And I will ask them, you know, to raise your hands if you can think of one. And then I will say, okay, now put down your hand if that person was a racial or ethnic underrepresented from racial or ethnic boundaries. Put your hand down if they were underrepresented with gender identity. Put your hand down if they had a learning disability or came from socioeconomic disadvantage, if they suffered with physical or mental illness. And it's astonishing to see how often when you look across the room, there are no more hands up. Those are instances that our systems can fail and that cause disparities. And we have the outcomes that our system is designed to create. And so I think about it, we often talk about it from the perspective of pipeline programs and or pathway programs. And we focus on trying to educate and change the individuals in those. That's like trying to change the water instead of, you know, breaking, pulling apart the pipes and replacing them, perhaps, or navigating that. And so what can our systems do to actually create equitable spaces where everyone has an opportunity to succeed, to achieve their full potential? What may take someone 3 years may take another person 6 years, because that's what their life journey is and how they've chosen it. And it doesn't make one better than the other. It just makes us different.
Wow, that was really powerful. Navigate a system not made for us. I wrote that one down. Really powerful. Thank you for that. So, you know, we've identified the disparities for entry, advancement, and then during training. So let's shift more to talking about solutions for these things. And so, you know, Dr. Clayton and Dr. again, McNeal-Trice, what are some national programs that you're aware of or initiatives to address some of these inequities?
So I'll go ahead and get started and share some information about some of the NIH programs and other things I'm aware of. So I like to think about some of the work that we do on three domains, and that's convening, catalyzing, and communicating to drive change. So I love alliteration, so that'll help me remember it. But one of the convenings that we did actually is more than just convening, it's supporting, was a National Academies meeting on promising practices for advancing underrepresentation of women in STEM. So we supported that effort. We were leading that effort. There were other funders, but we led that effort. And because we led that effort, meaning the Office of Research on Women's Health, we incorporated a specific question related to women of color in the activity. We ensured that it was resourced to be able to include that as an explicit element. And so that was that report was generated. It showed that there's underrepresentation, you know, by every career stage, race, ethnicity, and discipline. And we know that it showed that bias, discrimination, and harassment are major drivers for this. It showed that we have made some progress in some areas, but not so much for women of color. And it also showed that we do have some effective strategies for advancing women in STEM, but they primarily are effective for white women. And we don't have as much information, data about what works for other women with intersecting identities, and that we needed that information. So by funding that report, we generated scholarly work and recommendations for the ecosystem. So that's a resource. So creating resources is an important aspect of this. We also have a working group on women in biomedical careers at NIH that I have the privilege of co-chairing with the NIH director. And that working group is charged with addressing the barriers to advancing women in STEM through policies and programs. And so that working group has initiated new research on the factors that are associated with women progressing, new research on, you know, actually randomized controlled trials on interventions to advance women. We have initiated policy change, like, you know, providing childcare support for NRSAs. And we've convened meetings, and there's a variety of materials on our website. It's womeninscience.nih.gov, and I'll put it in the chat. Under that working group, there's a Women of Color Committee focused specifically on the concerns of women of color for anyone who is supportive of, an ally of, and trying to make the way for women of color in STEM. And that Women of Color Committee has had a variety of activities, including, you know, hosting individuals who are at our Wednesday afternoon lecture series. And Dr. Bernard was the former chair of that committee before she took on additional responsibilities in her new position. That committee also created a LinkedIn community called the Women of Color Research Network, where we provide information for women of color and their supporters on advancement of biomedical sciences, how to navigate the NIH system, career development tips, and it's a forum for networking and sharing. There are about 2,400 members of that LinkedIn group. So creating spaces for that information. We also reward institutions who have done a good job. And this was actually an activity of the Working Group on Women in Biomedical Careers as well. And there's a gender prize, Advancing Gender Equity Prize, that we gave out 2 years ago. And the content of the prize winners, how they achieved increasing gender equity, was created and is actually on our website, so that can be shared publicly. So we provide that information. And we are nearly there with creating a toolkit so that you could search that and see if there's an institution like yours, what worked for someone else where. We raise visibility of leaders. So I think that Dr. McNeal-Trice mentioned, or I can't remember who it was, mentioned about the importance of people not seeing people like them in a space. And so we have a Pearls of Wisdom video series where we have leaders talk about these issues and students. We have down to medical students talking about these issues, so different levels. And it's called the Pearls of Wisdom series. Dr. Bernard's in our series, so you can hear her talk about her career there. All of this is available on the ORWH website. And then I'll just mention one of our career development, I'll mention two other things. So our career development program, so it's an institutional K-12. It's building interdisciplinary research careers in women's health. So this is the purpose of this program is to expand the number of women's health researchers. They are women and men, but they're majority women. And over the years, we've been encouraging them to partner with minority-serving institutions, HBCUs, tribal colleges. And at this point, we've trained over 700 scholars. About 27% are from underrepresented groups. So that's another effort that incorporates these considerations. We also partner with the National Medical Association, which is the Association of African American Physicians. You may be aware that African American physicians were not able to join the American Medical Association, so had to form the National Medical Association. And so we partner with NMA every year and the National Institute of Diabetes, Digestive and Kidney Diseases to host research seminars at the national meeting so that we can expose medical students and trainees to research careers as an opportunity. And we've been privileged to do that for many, many years. So I mentioned just a few of them, and I'll stop there to give my colleague an opportunity to weigh in as well.
Wow, that was amazing. It's a tough act to follow. But I would say just for things that not to overlap, national resources that are available for everyone, and some resources that I found out very early, there are robust resources. Available through the Association of American Medical Colleges, the AAMC. I remember very early, within a year of me becoming a junior faculty member, I was advised to consider the seminar, or being nominated to attend the seminar for early career women in medicine and science that the AAMC sponsored. I remember going to that and literally emailing two of my other junior colleagues who had signed on at the exact time as I did and saying, this is the best development conference I have ever been to in my entire life. Oh my goodness. I was sitting in the audience, and now, roughly 15, 16 years later, it still is one of the best conferences I have ever been to in my entire life. I still remember the individuals that were on the panel, the women who were at the table I was sitting at, and even just getting advice about things that were in my blind spot, how to walk into a room, how to introduce yourself, where to put your name tag, like, that individuals review our CV, and I've not had someone who wasn't at my institution review it before and say, you know, I don't know anything about you reading this, like, this needs to be, it was amazing. It led me to become more involved with our the group in Women in Medicine and Science for the AAMC. And for those of you who have not visited that page and seen that resource, I can put the link in the chat. I also have it pulled up here, but even just visiting that web resource It has just so many resources that are free for you to see. There are toolkits and webinars, and the toolkits involved so many things, especially with regards to career advancement, how to leverage your career, how to get nominations, whether you're writing your own nomination for an award, or asking someone else, seeking awards and say, would you nominate me for this? You'd be surprised. We sit and wait for people to nominate us for something instead of going out and seeing the award and then telling them, nominate us. how institutional strategies, those types of things. And this is just to name a few. I attended the Early Career for Women, if you're underrepresented in medicine. The WIMSC also has a faculty development seminar for underrepresented minorities in medicine and science. This is where, during both of those, I learned about ELON. Many of the individuals that were at the previous development seminars were graduates or ELONs. I think y'all probably know a little bit about that, just a little bit. So I won't go into detail. Once you get into a little bit of that framework and network, and when I say network, I like to use the word communities a little bit more, because I feel like that's fellowship that you can give and take. Those communities begin informing you about other opportunities that you previously weren't aware of. And so this year I'm participating in the Council of Deans Fellowship for the WIMSC. I had no idea what that was. Even 2 years ago, but my exposure and work with not only within the committees of the AAMC, but with the individuals that I've met there, provided information about that and engaged me. And it was another example of, I want to do this. And then you point to someone, nominate me for this. So those are just a couple examples, and there's a wealth of resources, and they're at no cost. And I think that's the other thing. When I say no cost, there are a lot of resources that are online that aren't no cost, but even the cost of these development resources can be footed by your institutions. And so that was another thing that I learned about, that you don't have to fund this out of your own dollars, that these are ways that your institution can invest in you.
Excellent. Thank you. So, go ahead. Was someone going to speak? No. Okay. So kind of moving from the national level down to more local level, this question is for Dr. Irons and Dr. Bernard. How do you recommend people getting involved and working with their leadership to address the inequities that we've discussed today?
Great. So I'll start. I think that it's a great question. I wanted to follow up a little on the last speaker, and only to say that nominate yourself is really important. I have to say every educational program that I had in Boston was because I walked up to my department chair and said, hey, there's this MACE course. Hey, there's this other course I'd love to go. And the answer was always great. You know, take the time off and I'll pay for it. You know, there are hundreds of people in the department, and I don't think I would have gone or attended if I hadn't asked. It even got to the point where the secretaries in the Department of Pediatrics knew what courses I wanted to do, so they would actually point them out to me as the flyers came in. So it's always important to let your intentions, you know, let people know your intentions. With regards to the question that you actually asked me, I think the first thing to think about is identify what the problem is. And data is really important. Because in the absence of data, all you really have is anecdote. So if you're thinking about, you know, an institutional issue that has to be fixed, look for the data. Look at what search committees are, you know, how search committees are convened. Look at how promotion committees are convened. Is it a problem at the institution, or is this a national problem that can be, that affects people across institutions? And then, you know, call the question. I can tell you that just as an example, the discussion with regards to maternity leaves during graduate medical education started 6 or 7 years ago at the WIMSC. There was a session at the WIMSC and talking about the fact that institutions had different, either had no or different types of maternity leaves for residents and fellows. And I was in one session and I was the SVP of ABMS. Another SVP of ACGME was in the other session. This was discussed. We met in the hall and said, well, we really have to do something about this. And so it was really identifying the people at the two organizations that were responsible for this and making and starting the conversation. It was completely fortuitous, but it doesn't require, you know, people to be at a meeting in the same room to do it. It just requires knowing who to call. And it took probably 5 years before we got, you know, 24 independent certifying boards came up with what, you know, their requirements were, and ACGME was able to change their requirements. But that was a big forcing function for GME. You know, institutions actually ended up having to do the right thing. And the national organizations that were seen as barriers came along. So knowing who can help you and calling the question is always really important. I think that, you know, for individuals, it's really important to think about what is important to you and what your path, professional path is, and how that path might change. There was a little discussion about this in the last panel, but we all go into medicine, I think, especially younger people, thinking that there's this straight path. And, you know, we're going to start here and we're going to end up there. And what you learn, or at least what I've learned, is that life throws you a lot of curves. And my life especially is, you know, has a lot of curves and switchbacks. Although I tend to keep going in, you know, one general direction, but it requires thinking about yourself differently. It requires reevaluating your professional goals. And it requires you to think about what's important to me and then identifying the advocates in whatever institution you're in that can help you think that through and help you get to what you need. The other thing that's important, I think, is identifying other people that are thinking in the same way. You know, groups of people and support is really important for people. And I think that you have to understand that for any problem that you bring up that's important to you, there are also at least two different narratives. And the answer to that problem is somewhere in the middle. And, you know, starting the conversation and recognizing that everyone, I think, has good intentions and is moving in the right direction is important. But, you know, if I had to distill this, think in your head, is this an institutional problem? Is this just something that's important at my institution? If that's the answer, then work within your institution. Identify your advocates, bring everybody to the table. I'm a big proponent of bring everybody to the table, even the people that you know are going to disagree with you, because you can often move them. If it's a national problem and it affects people across medicine, then look to WIMSC, look to ACGME, look to the ABMS boards, because you can get that to happen. I'll talk a little about search programs, because I heard somebody say, you know, talk about not knowing where to, you know, how to walk in a room and how to do things. Nobody teaches you that. And, you know, I was on my second search, and I think one of my former coaches is on this call. You know, I didn't know where to put my hands, you know, when you're interviewing for a position or how to write that dreaded letter. And I think that's where organizations like ELAM, and Nancy, I have to thank you publicly. ELAM has been amazing, in helping women go through that process. And not only understanding how to go through that process, but also getting your name on the list. And that's one thing that women, I think, don't do as well as men. I think we mentor really well. We try to give people the ability to, the tools to survive and to thrive, but we don't make introductions as well as men do. And I, you know, I'm in a world where there's a lot of men, and I look around the room and they're all black suits. And, you just see so many men reaching out and putting their hand on a young man's elbow and steering them over to another group of older men. It's just done automatically. They don't even think about it. And women, I don't think, do that as much. I think we're better at it. But this issue of sponsorship is really, really important. You can't, and sometimes you have to ask. Sometimes you have to look at a job and say, you know, that one really interests me. Can you put my name in for that? And that's something I think that we don't think about that often. So sorry, I know I was all over the place on this, but hopefully it was helpful.
Definitely. And Dr. Bernard, would you like to speak to that as well?
Yes. I mean, I think Dr. Irons really very eloquently covered all of the things that I would have said. But I just want to reinforce that, you know, the question is, how do you recommend people get involved in working with leadership to address the inequities that we've discussed today? And that depending upon career stage, you can have more or less of an influence. Early in my career, as an assistant professor, I was approached to be assistant dean for diversity at my medical school and was advised, thank heavens, by a very good mentor that it was really important for me to establish my academic credentials and bona fides before I went in that direction. It's one thing if that's what your research area is. It's another thing if it's an added responsibility. And so frequently, women and individuals from underrepresented groups get a lot of service responsibilities without the opportunity to build their academic careers. And that's the reason we're doing things like the diversity supplements for mentoring and the opportunity to compete for awards for mentoring. And we're trying to talk with professional organizations, academic and scientific organizations about considering service in promotion and advancement. But as I think it was Dr. McNeal-Trice pointed out, the system is an old system, not necessarily designed for individuals who are willing to give themselves to mentor. And I would just encourage you, if you're early in your career, be selfish and focus in on what's necessary for you to make your advances. But yes, if there is something that's going on systematically within the system in which you live that's making for a barrier for you, bring together your allies, bring together your data. Objective data is so important. A great example of that is the launching of the NIH Unite initiative. I kind of talked about it in shorthand, but it has the audacious goal of ending structural racism. It was launched in response to the disparate morbidity and mortality we saw from the COVID pandemic at the beginning in 2020, and then the videotaped murder of George Floyd. That summer, there were some really intense discussions within NIH among leadership. What should we do? What should we do? And it was early career staff at NIH who got together and got some really good hard data, quantitative data, qualitative data, brought it to the most senior of the leadership and said, look, this is where we stand. And that really was a tipping point for leadership to say, yes, this problem isn't just outside of NIH. It's something that we need to address. So coming together with others, using your data, being very grounded in evidence are things that I would suggest. And being ready to speak truth to power. That group of early career scientists spoke truth to power, and they are making change within our organization. And as you mature in your career, yes, please do the sorts of things Dr. Irons described to make a difference for others and to volunteer and to take someone by the shoulder and bring them along to make sure they get mentored and sponsored, because that makes all the difference in the world for people's advancement. So those are the only things I would add to what has already been mentioned.
Frank, thank you. That's excellent. So, you know, on the individual level, we can leverage, right, our positions to negotiate for ourselves for more equitable outcomes as well. So we're going to put up a Zoom poll and ask what factors have you considered when approaching negotiations? All right. So it looks like most of us have looked towards negotiating title, time and effort. And then the others are pretty much similar: space, culture, other hires, other intangibles. So great. So our theme today, you know, is the great renewal negotiation. And given the results of the poll, it seems that we in some ways do have some similar things that we do think about when approaching negotiations. So with that in mind, I'd like to ask the panel, what would you like to see people ask for both themselves and or colleagues that would make a difference in promoting equity? And then who wants to start?
One of the things that has been a real interest of mine since we were able to demonstrate at the height of the pandemic that we could get our work done virtually is I would love to see people advocate for virtual options. We saw that when it came to a meeting, we had many more people to attend, much more diversity among the people who were attendees. We saw from our own internal NIH polls that our staff who were working virtually had, in many cases, a better sense of quality of life than when they were doing that big commute to get into Bethesda. And I would love, I in fact made a run at trying to get NIH to consider making a statement about this, like we made a statement about mammals, that we'd make it a statement that we wouldn't participate in scientific meetings unless there was a virtual option. It wasn't successful. But I'd really love to see everyone here advocating for that for themselves and for others, because it has really, I think, been one of those silver linings of the pandemic that can be really helpful to women, to people from underrepresented groups, people who are socioeconomically deprived or come from a lower resourced institution, to allow them to more fully participate in all that we're doing.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely, that's a great one.
Yeah. I would just, I'd really focus on resources, on human resources, asking for additional positions, because especially you can assume going into a job that you're not going to have the diversity that you want there with the people in that. And so you're going to need to hire additional people. And having the resources to do that is really important. So, you know, first there has to be a recognition at going in that you've got diversity issues, and then how do I solve them? The other thing, and I was interested in the fact that people, 39% of people asked about the culture of the institution. And I think culture is obviously really important. You know, there is that saying that culture eats strategy for breakfast. I'd love to know how honest people were with regards to the culture, that culture question. Because in my experience, that's the hardest in many ways. You know, if you have the resources, the culture of an institution is the hardest to deal with.
Thank you. Mm-hmm. Dr. McNeal-Trice?
I was looking through my list. I'd made a list of things and was going to try to cross them off so I wouldn't be too repetitive. I would say probably one of the first and most important things I would discuss or do with regards to negotiation is prepare. The number of times individuals will walk into a setting where they are in a position of negotiating and haven't prepared or done their homework is astonishing. And negotiation is not going in and waiting to see what you're offered and then rebutting. A negotiation is going in knowing what you want. Want and or need with regards to the role, and then having that discussion and what are the BAFTAs, some people BAFTAs know that, but the best alternative to a negotiated agreement, like what hill are you gonna die on? Like, nope. And we're like, oh, okay, we have wiggle room there. And I cannot say how important it is to prepare for that. Some key points I would say are titles. Individuals, I Unfortunately, I've heard more women than men say titles aren't important. Yeah, they are, especially when they can signify what your leadership role is within the institution. And so that is something I have negotiated for before. And sometimes the title doesn't exist yet. And you may say, I'm going to do this role. I know this is what you call it, but this is the title that I would like for it to have, not only for it to be recognized as what I do within the institution, but also nationally and regionally, what your responsibility is. I can't say how important doing your homework with regards to salaries is. And I think the AAMC, some of our work on the group for the Steering Committee for Group in Women in Medicine and Science, has done some groundbreaking work in making those salary tables more transparent and accessible. There used to be the secret person in your institution that held that table, and some people knew who it was and some people didn't. And if you didn't, then you were just out. And if you happened to have a sponsor or a mentor who knew who held the table and could go to them and have them pull it out of their file drawer, and it really can be a challenge. And so doing that homework, and sometimes it involves you actually contacting an individual at another institution and saying they may have access to it, and say what happens in the Southeast versus the Northwest versus an academic institution, a public, private, women, all of that is there, and having that available. Salary is not, I think all of us know, salary is not the same thing as compensation. And individuals will have salary, especially at some of our public institutions published, and you know they make way more than that. And so recognizing what is part of a full compensation package. What's the administrative supplement that you're getting, you can get on top of that? Are there funds for CME? And when I think of CME, to pay for your memberships, your meetings, preparation for those types of things. We often think about office space, but office location is important. You may have chief or senior dean in front of your name, yet your office is in the basement versus where everyone else is who has that title. That can be important. The access to other individuals physically during the workday. I think many of us who've been in certain leadership roles for a while know how much gets done that walk to and from the coffee, getting a cup of coffee, or down the hall, or just being able to pop in and have that. It provides a lot of, that interaction that you would not have if you weren't even in the physical space where the people that make decisions and have the power to make those decisions are. And then I would say, last but not least, and this was something I learned, I didn't even know you can negotiate for promotion and tenure. I remember the first time someone, said, my mentor said to me, yeah, and you need to put on your offer letter, you want tenure. And I was like, oh, you can do that? Sorry, I'll just let my face say that. And that's another example of a question of things that you getting advice and guidance about things that you didn't even know you could ask for.
Yeah.
Negotiate for, because you're not asking for a handout. You're negotiating what your skills and talents are worth.
Mm-hmm. Very good. Yeah. Dr. Janet Fitzpatrick had mentioned to me, it's hard, how do you negotiate for equitable salaries when it seems to be a lack of transparency in what others make, and, trying to access these tables. And like you said, do the legwork in order to find them can be very difficult. Yes. Mm-hmm. Thank you. And then Dr. Clayton, would you want to finish us off, please?
Sure. I know we're a little over time, and I just want to say my colleagues have mentioned so many things, and so I will not add them, all those things that they said and more. Let me just end with a notion that I would wish for folks, that they would be able to spend the time to decide what their goals are, their ultimate goals, that they would take the time with themselves. And a piece of that is realizing, you don't have to compete with anybody else. You don't have to do what anybody else is doing. You need to aspire to be the best version of your own self. And whatever that is, which could be being a dean or CEO, or could be living in South America for 6 months of the year and the US for 6 months, whatever your best version of yourself is, And then having the advocating for yourself for the flexibility to be able to make that happen for you. I don't know what it is with these younger generations. I'm a mother of a millennial too. And, you know, I had one walk into my office with her sneakers on in an interview straight from the lab. Oh, we're interviewing in sneakers. Okay, that's okay. And asked to create a position. She made up the pieces. Well, you know, she got it, right? We said, okay, if we can make that work, sure. Figure out what you want, you know, and it's your own best version of yourself that you're after, not competing with somebody else. Although, you know, of course, it should be fair. You know, my colleagues have already said all that.
Excellent. Thank you all so much for your time and your wonderful expertise. You're all such inspiring leaders. Thank you for being here. Mm-hmm.
So thank you all for that. Thank you to all the panelists. That was such an exciting and just really informative conversation that we all had.